Angled glass and thick concrete walls reinforced with steel gave the launch control center an imposing, unique look. But it was the brains of the launch control center that made it famous as the only facility in the world smart enough to launch a 36-story rocket and three astronauts off the planet so they could set their feet on another world. Best known by its acronym, the LCC at NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida would go on to operate as the nerve center for every launch carrying a crew through Apollo, NASA's first space station program called Skylab, the Apollo-Soyuz mission with the Soviet Union, and then the 30 years and more than 130 launches of the space shuttle.
Well, back in the 60s, during the Apollo program, this was the hub, as it were, the central control center. This was the control room for all the activity associated with the launch facilities, the rocket, and the spacecraft, the payload for the Apollo missions.
The launch control center was built around one thing: launching men to the moon. The rocket that ended up carrying out that mission, the Saturn V, was the largest ever built and far more powerful and complicated than anything that had come before it. Up until the Saturn V, the launch teams for Redstone, Atlas, and Titan II rockets fit in a single room at the base of the launch pad called a blockhouse.
So the blockhouse might have 1,000 square feet in it. So when people had a problem, and believe me, we had problems, and we learned from every one of them. We could get everybody that needed to contribute to the management decisions together by just gathering them around some console where the problem was being displayed. When we came to 39 and had a much bigger management structure, more organizations, more complicated hardware, then we had to come up with a new concept.
The task for the LCC's designers was complicated by the fact that when the structure was designed and built, NASA had not settled on the way they would get to the moon. There were still heated debates about everything from how many rockets would be needed for a single lunar landing to where spacecraft would rendezvous in space.
So we had to come up with a concept that would work no matter what path they finally chose.
The LCC was the first launch control center that was not within the launch pad's perimeter. Instead, the LCC was built 3 miles from where the Saturn V's massive F1 engines would ignite in the thunder of 7.5 million pounds of thrust. The building's architectural focal point is a set of windows about 2 stories tall that run the length of the building facing Launch Complexes 39A and 39B. Metal shutters were installed over the windows for protection.
The shutters were there to close because we were afraid that the acoustic energy would be so great when we fired the engines of the Saturn V that it would just break the glass of the windows.
The heart of the LCC lies in 4 large areas on the 3rd floor, called the firing rooms. Miles and miles of cables and wires arrayed throughout Kennedy Space Center's 140,000 acres end here. As spacecraft and rockets were prepared, signals from hangars, assembly rooms, and the launch pad were sent to the LCC. Though identical, the rooms would be used differently during a mission to cater to specific team needs. Each one would be used as the central room for certain launches and support rooms for others.
You know, I worked in the Launch Control Center for over 20 years, almost 25 years. And when I first took a job there, we had dial phones, we had rotary phones in the firing room. I remember when we first got our push-button phones, that was a big deal. And fax machine, we never had a fax machine in the firing room until, you know, late 80s. So technology really changed a lot. The thing that didn't change was the operating system for processing the shuttle. The guys that worked shuttle, they had to learn that operating language and learn it very well, obviously. But it wasn't applicable to the outside world, so it was a unique application just for shuttle processing.
More than 100 engineers filled the firing rooms on launch day, each one working a specific system or task as part of a carefully choreographed team that would not let a crew of astronauts lift off until the machinery of spaceflight was ready. Diligence and discipline were the watchwords for anyone who dreamt of working in a firing room.
And the one thing that was drilled in by our management and the operations folks was that when you came into this room, you were in a different environment. There was no games in here. There was no pushing and shoving. There was no joking. This is important things are done in this room, and your focus has to be on your responsibility. It was discipline, discipline, discipline.
What it took was not just a complete knowledge of that system. It took a dedication to be able to feel the conviction in your heart and go against the grain if you had to call a no-go if you had to, not be a wallflower, but stand up for that system or in the safety world, whatever it may be. So it took a combination of technical smarts and a dedication and conviction to the safety of the crew and to the vehicles to sit in that prime room.
The architecture inside the firing room featured raised platforms at the front of the room, lowering to a set of horseshoe cabinets, and was not done by accident or even by necessity.
This again goes back to the heritage of the human spaceflight and launch business, and it started over on the Cape side with the launches from the blockhouses, and it was to remind people that went in the blockhouse for the launch that the test conductors and the launch directors were in charge, and so their consoles were elevated relative to the systems engineers who were on the floor, as it were, and executed the procedures.
Designers carried the tradition over to the new LCC, which was much larger than previous control rooms.
One of the things we observed as systems engineers was that the test conductors and launch directors kept getting higher and higher relative to the floor, where us floor workers worked.
The rooms were staffed most of the time during the Apollo and early shuttle program years.
Well, a normal day was a day and a night usually. So there was always at least a test conductor in here and some facilities and ground support equipment stuff. If you powered up any stage of the Saturn V rocket or if the spacecraft was powered up, then that added more people to the room. It was an all up with all the systems up. You'd have 50, 75 people in this room.
The rooms also featured areas in each corner where people not associated with the launch could watch the action unfold without interfering or distracting the controllers.
We called them the management rooms on each side of the test conductors and launch director console. And the management that came in were not part of the execution of the procedures during the launch count, but they didn't have the ability to connect directly with the astronauts or with the engineers. And that's why they enclosed the bubbles, so that they would not be a distraction for those of us on the floor.
It was a very, very insightful decision way back when to have VIPs in the room available for an extremely tough call if necessary, but keep them away from the launch team. Let us get the vehicle ready to fly and then turn it over to the flight control team in Houston to execute the mission. And so if we got into a situation where we were outside the launch commit criteria and even outside the bounds, the authority of the mission management team, which was created after Challenger, we could turn to the administrator and ask his opinion.
Although it was designed for one kind of rocket, the LCC has proven adaptable to the extraordinary needs of rockets and spacecraft carrying humans into space. Following the landmark successes of launching 9 missions to the moon, controllers in the LCC launched America's first space station, Skylab, along with 3 crews to operate it in orbit. The launch of the first international cooperation mission, the Apollo-Soyuz test project, was also conducted in the LCC, where the liftoff was carefully timed so the two spacecraft launched from different parts of the world would link in orbit. After the Apollo and Saturn V programs ended, NASA modified the LCC for a dynamic new spacecraft, the Space Shuttle. The LCC was updated to meet the demands of the new spacecraft, but it kept its character.
It's a reminder of, I'll call it, Yankee ingenuity. The people that laid out the whole launch control center here, all four firing rooms, they did that in the early 60s. They tried to get the best they could to think about the future uses and demands and requirements. They had to think through that. And in hindsight, they did it exactly right.
When I first started out in the mid 80s, we still had the old Apollo consoles in the control rooms. Those old bluish consoles and, you know, steel and were made for Apollo. And so we process and launch, gosh, the first two-thirds of the shuttle program using those old consoles. And then along in the early 2000s, firing room four got upgraded as part of a system to upgrade the operating system. We wanted to get into a more advanced operating system, and the legacy of that program was the consoles got updated, so they looked real nice, but the operating system, the guts of the actual computer program, never did change. Very few people know that. So it looks good on TV, but it was the old operating system. So firing four, you know, when we got that up and running, that was everybody felt good. They felt, you know, brand new room and felt good coming to work.
What happened in the LCC's firing rooms inspired millions around the world. With the center built and outfitted with computers and digital networks, a staff unlike any other could focus on the rockets and spacecraft that would launch humans into deep space during Apollo and make spaceflight a more common occurrence during the Space Shuttle era.